I'm Rick Romano. I'm head of the Global Real Estate Securities Group at PGIM Real Estate. I've been in real estate for over 30 years, and today is one of the most dynamic real estate markets that I've ever seen. There are opportunities that are being generated by reflation, reopening, and a recalibration of technology in the real estate space that we haven't seen before. PGIM Real Estate manages over $195 billion globally, and that is split up between real estate private equity, real estate debt, and real estate securities. The group started in 1970 and has expanded globally ever since. It was one of the first groups to ever do commingled private real estate funds. It has since evolved to have a securities group, which I'm a part of, that manages $4 billion. And we co-founded that group back in 2005. And we have several products as a result of within securities. We've got a select strategy, which is our best ideas across the world. We have a core strategy, a US strategy, an income strategy, which is a higher dividend yield. And all of those together total $4.2 billion today. I co-founded the Global Real Estate Group about 15 years ago or so. Prior to that, I had several years of experience in the private real estate group, including private equity, and also worked for the Rockefeller Company, covering REITs globally back in the mid-90s. The team is split up across three regions across the world. Real estate is a local business, so having a local team in each region is very important, and having boots on the ground. We have a team that is in the US, which is led by Dan Cooney. We have three analysts there as well. And what they do is cover, they're responsible for net asset value and a total stock return for each company that they cover. We have a team in Europe, which does the same, and a team in Asia, which does the same as well. And so each analyst and portfolio manager is responsible for covering 20 to 35 stocks in their investment universe. And we meet weekly, and in those weekly meetings, as a result of that bottom-up process, we make investment decisions and we vote by committee in those weekly meetings. I think they should think of it first and foremost as real estate. These REITs own real estate property. That's the main asset that they have, and that's the cash flows correlate 100% to commercial real estate. Now, when you're allocating assets within a stock and bond portfolio, I think you think about real estate and REITs as a hybrid of both stocks and bonds. So they have an income component. These companies generally pay a higher dividend as they pass rents through to shareholders. But they also have growth attached to them. That income is not fixed. So unlike a bond, that income grows over time as rents increase and landlords are able to increase rents. And what that typically means is in many cases, you have growth above inflation or in line with inflation, because many of the leases are structured to have contractual inflationary bumps in the lease each year. So it ends up being a great hybrid vehicle between a stock and a bond. And when you include it in your portfolio, it definitely adds to the expected return and lowers the risk for a portfolio. From what's going on in terms of technology disruption. And those property types might include data centers, which, as the demand for streaming services increases, demand for data centers increases, cell towers, 5G rollout, demand for cell phone usage continues to grow. And then if you look at what's happening with e-commerce, warehouses and industrial are really benefiting as sales are pulled from bricks and mortar retail. The product is now sitting in a last mile warehouse, and then that's creating additional demand for that. You also have property types like hotels, self-storage, apartments, all those property types have really good fundamentals right now. And then healthcare. which is a big component of our universe. It's assisted living, it's hospitals. So when you think about real estate, I think you think about it's every different type of real estate, even have casinos in the investment universe. So it's a very broad market with the ability for active managers to really add value here. The REIT market is about $2.5 trillion of global market cap. So in the US, that's about 1.5, and the rest of the world, it's about $1 billion. So it is a very liquid, deep market with a broad menu of property types to access, access to tremendous management teams. Some of the best developers and landlords in the world are in managed REITs. So the menu is quite large, the opportunity set is quite large, and it really allows active managers to be able to take advantage of that. When you think about the splits across the world, you know, it's about 60% in North America, about 30% in Asia, and about 10% in Europe. So, you know, a pretty broad menu to choose from as we think about the world globally. The characteristics of REIT returns really consist of two components. You have the income component and you have a growth component, essentially. And the income component typically represents about 30 to 40% of the total return of REITs. Over long periods of time, REITs have averaged 10% total returns. And the volatility has been in line or less than your equity markets. So when you put that into a diversified portfolio, it really can add to the return and lower your risk. It can put you in a better position than just a typical 60% stock portfolio, 40% bond portfolio. If you were to add 10% of REITs into that portfolio, you could see an improvement in your, not only your returns, but a reduction in risk because of the diversification benefits that REITs give you. When we look globally across each of the regions in terms of real estate, we see some very common themes. Those themes include we're seeing starting to see reflation across the world. We're seeing the reopening in terms of COVID start to fully take effect after we've gone through some of the variants, whether it was the Delta variant or others. And those themes are consistent throughout the world in terms of the impact on real estate. We're seeing a lot of pent-up demand for things like travel, whether it's leisure or corporate, and that's providing opportunities in areas like hotels. We're seeing pent-up demand in areas like assisted living, where people couldn't move into those facilities during the pandemic, and that's creating opportunities. On the inflationary side, we're seeing strong demand in property types that have short lease durations. So whether it's a one-month lease or a one-year lease, we're seeing the ability for landlords to increase pricing significantly there as inflation increases. And then of course, those leases or those property types that have embedded CPI increases in their lease are really benefiting relative to fixed income investments. So we think that the global environment, considering what's going on with interest rates, inflation, and the reopening, paints a very good backdrop for active managers within real estate right now. Historically, inflation has been beneficial to real estate and REIT returns. So when you see periods of inflation going back to the 70s, you've seen REITs do very well relative to bonds, relative to common stocks, and private real estate do well. And the reason for that is many of the leases do have a contractual CPI or inflation escalator built right into the lease. When people think about real estate, they think about the income component, but the good news is that the income grows, that it's not fixed like a bond. And during periods of inflation, you'll see a lot of investment managers, a lot of chief investment officers will move money out of bonds into real estate to get that inflation protection. The other benefit in terms of inflation is that inflation really increases construction costs. And when construction costs go up so much, supply tends to get limited. So when you see limited supply, it's good for existing landlords or owners of real estate because they can increase rents at a higher level until it justifies new supply. And when you think about the labor at the real estate property and wage inflation, generally speaking, most real estate property types are not labor intensive. So if you're worried about wage inflation, a self-storage property type, as an example, typically has one or zero employees. And even an apartment community, with what we've seen in COVID, they're really working, they're using less labor at those apartment communities because they've been able to manage through COVID without having people on site. So it is a huge benefit to be invested in real estate in an inflationary environment. Geographically, we divide the world into three broad regions: the North America, which is US and Canada, Europe, which includes continental Europe, the UK and the Nordics, and then Asia Pacific, which really in the REIT world includes Japan, Hong Kong, Singapore, and Australia. And the good news about global real estate investing is that each of those parts of the world may have very different real estate characteristics or be in different points of the real estate cycle. So what we really focus on is the characteristics of supply and demand in each of those regions. And then beyond each of those regions, really drilling down at the country level and then the property type level within that country to see where are the best fundamentals right now, where are the best supply demand characteristics, the best opportunities for rent growth, and what is the world undervaluing right now in terms of real estate. So the opportunity set becomes very broad when you look globally. The other thing that we look at globally is oftentimes we'll see a real estate trend or a new real estate idea evolve. And many times that might occur in the US, and we see it get exported outside of the US. So manufactured housing was a good example where we saw institutional capital get invested in that space for the first time about 5 years ago. And we were able to look across the world and find a company in Australia that had very similar characteristics. And we knew what was going to happen. We knew institutional quality investors were going to come into that property type and drive prices up. And we did see that happen in Australia. So having the global menu, you can export characteristics for different property types, emerging property types. You can use that and export that across the world to your benefit. In our benchmark, we do have some companies that are listed in Singapore that invest directly in India. However, the listed market for REITs and real estate in India is not that big yet. So when you look at things like real estate benchmarks and REIT benchmarks, India is not in those benchmarks. So we do have access to some, you know, good assets, whether they're technology specific assets located in Mumbai, through an industrial distribution assets through Singapore. So there's a way to access real estate within India in a global REIT listed security vehicle. However, it's typically indirect and not going direct to listed companies on the India Stock Exchange. The real estate cycle globally, in many points in time, it's not highly correlated. So you'll see the US might be in a different cycle than Japan or Europe. So that really provides the opportunity to take advantage of what part of the world or what country is sort of in the best position in their real estate cycle. So you get the advantage of that dislocation. But beyond that, historically, real estate cycles last pretty long. And we did see a big reset due to COVID very recently. And that reset has really reset the table for real estate growth going forward and for winners and losers in the space. So we think that we are, in many cases, in many property types, at the very early innings in terms of resetting earnings growth expectations. And we see fundamentals, whether it's supply, which was very much limited during COVID, a lot of projects were shut down, things couldn't be built. So a supply picture that looks attractive for current owners of real estate for fundamentals and price increases, and a recovering economy as we come out of COVID and get to a really full, robust global reopening, that means there's pent-up demand for a lot of real estate, and we'll see spikes in usage in many cases. So we think that this reopening combined with reflation, it makes it a great time to enter real estate at this point, as we're just beginning those trends and starting to see them take off across the world. So in terms of themes that we're seeing consistently across the world, we are seeing technology disruption of real estate globally. And that means that, the first place we really saw was e-commerce. We're seeing e-commerce disrupt bricks and mortar real estate. And that's very much benefiting, that's disrupting retail real estate. That's very much benefiting industrial and warehouse space. So the shirt that you bought at a mall or a shopping center now sits at a last mile warehouse and gets delivered directly to your garage. The other theme that we're seeing globally, which has been accelerated by the pandemic, is work from home. That has been disrupting the office space, commercial office usage throughout the world. And when you look at it, it's worked better than we thought it would. And that's going to result in a hybrid model for many companies and ultimately less demand for office space across the world. We do think some of the well-located Class A office that is up to code on ESG needs for both regulators and tenants can do well. But overall, that market may shrink a bit, and that's benefiting data centers, where people are home now streaming work content or using resources at home for video conference meetings. So that's a big benefit. ESG is the other global trend that we're seeing, very much a focus on what are going to be the capital investments that real estate companies need to make to get their properties up to regulatory code for ESG purposes, or just tenant needs for ESG purposes. Many tenants are very much focused on having greener buildings. So there was a race within real estate globally to get to carbon neutral footprints, as an example. And that's really gonna, that capital spend, who gets that right, is really gonna determine some winners and losers in the space over the next 5 years or so. So the pandemic pulled forward certain areas of growth that would have occurred over a longer period of time, but really very much got pulled forward by the pandemic. So I would say e-commerce, and in particular grocery e-commerce, was lightly penetrated. Grocery e-commerce was lightly penetrated prior to the pandemic across the world. When you think about the percentage of people that were shopping online for grocery and food services, it was 2% or so. During the pandemic, people had to do that by need, and it created a lot of sticky customers. So that's really transforming how people think about, you know, we've already been transformed as how we think about shopping for many hard goods and non-needs-based items. But when you look at how, you know, grocery has changed over the past year or so into the pandemic and how that's going to change going forward, that has implications for what your certain shopping centers will look like. It has implications for cold storage warehouse, where when you can service from a last mile cold storage warehouse facility, you can have a big advantage in a grocery e-commerce model. So we've seen that demand get pulled forward. We've seen e-commerce get pulled forward even more. We've certainly seen work from home tested and working pretty well, which is going to have an impact on real estate going forward and how we live, work, and play. And then what we've seen in healthcare and hotels is that they have been the most disrupted by the pandemic, and we're starting to see demand come back. Not quite in full force yet, but pretty close. We had some fits and starts with variants of
COVID that have slowed things down, have slowed a full global reopening. But once that we get past that, we will see, you know, real robust demand for whether it's hotels, assisted living, anything that was really directly negatively impacted by COVID that doesn't have any long-term demand headwinds. In those areas, you've got demographics favoring travel, you've got demographics favoring healthcare. All those areas we think will benefit going forward. In terms of consumer trends, there are sustainable trends that we're seeing as a result of some of the themes that have occurred recently. Certainly the inclination and the willingness of the consumer to embrace online technology, whether it's for shopping, whether it's for shopping for hard goods, shopping for groceries, whether it's for streaming services and doing video calls. All of those consumer trends that have grown through COVID, you know, we think are sustainable. Now, the growth rate will probably start to, reduce a bit as we move forward because we're getting an early adapter growth rate that have been pretty high through COVID for some of these trends. But we think they're sustainable. The other consumer trend that we're seeing that we think is sustainable is that consumers of housing have shown an inclination to rent rather than own. And that's creating the need for areas like single family rentals, so single family homes that are being rented across the world. The consumer very much has a need for mobility and convenience. And those two trends of mobility and convenience will really dominate their choices with real estate going forward. So owners of real estate need to be, you know, able to adapt to that and make the lives of their tenants as easy, as convenient as possible to really have a competitive advantage going forward. Because these themes of convenience and mobility that the consumer really craves, those are not going away. We think those are sustainable long-term trends. What we found during the pandemic is that work from home can be beneficial for both employers and employees. For employees, it affects their work-life balance positively. For employers, there hasn't really been a drop-off in productivity, and ultimately they may be able to save money on their commercial office space usage. And the third benefit beyond that is there's benefit to the environment as people are commuting less, using less automobiles. It's beneficial for the carbon footprint. So for those reasons, we do think that there's going to be a somewhat of a permanent impact going forward. Before COVID, in the US, that was about 5% of the workforce was working from home. In the Nordics, it was about 15%. You know, we think that potentially we could go to 20%. It's possible that we go to more. Certainly a hybrid model would be the norm. Hard to say in a hybrid model as to how much office space is needed that is already out there and how much is going to be obsolete, essentially. But we do think there's going to be a permanent impact. But good office will still do well. Class A office that has ESG components, there'll always be demand for that in urban areas in particular. In terms of risks, when you're thinking about real estate securities, you have to think about geopolitical risks, macroeconomic risks that could affect the value of real estate securities. We try really hard to mitigate many of those risks by really focusing at the securities level and making a real estate decision and trying to control some of that macro and geopolitical risk, which generally you can diversify away from a bit by not making big, large overweights or underweights at the geographic level, at the region level or the country level. So the other risks that are typical in real estate would be development risk and balance sheet risk. We monitor those very carefully in our valuation process. And again, we'll invest in a company if we think the risk of their balance sheet is too great or the risk of their development pipeline is too great. we are real estate investors, so our process is very much focused on valuing the real estate that the company or the REIT owns. And we think we can get a real proprietary valuation through our integration with our private real estate group. When you think about real estate globally, 95% of it's held privately, commercial real estate, only 5% is held publicly. So we use our private real estate group to get great insights into valuing the real estate of the public companies. So we come up with a real estate value for the company, and then we don't stop there. We adjust the real estate value based on management team capabilities, corporate governance, liquidity, to get to a target stock price. If we stopped at real estate value, there are many companies that should be trading at a discount to the real estate value because they'll never take the right steps to resolve or eliminate that discount. The most extreme case being sell the company to monetize the real estate value. And then sometimes there's companies that should be trading at premiums to their real estate value because they're making good development decisions, good capital allocation decisions, good acquisitions to grow their earnings per share above and beyond the snapshot of their existing real estate. We're very much focused on risk mitigation. And while we have a bottom-up process, we do have a top-down risk mitigation overlay. So we roll up the portfolio and break it into a number of risk factors at the portfolio level and compare that to the risk factors at the benchmark level. So number one, we diversify globally, we diversify by property type, and we don't take positions that are more than 10% of the fund. But beyond that, we monitor development risk in the portfolio, balance sheet risk in the portfolio, interest rate risk sensitivity in the portfolio, and other factor risks in the portfolio, whether they might be large cap bias, small cap bias, momentum bias, growth versus value. All of that's monitored and adjusted as we roll up at the portfolio level to get it in line with ranges that we're comfortable with from a risk perspective for the portfolio. I think the factors that investors, particularly institutional investors, are looking at right now is we're in an inflationary environment that we really haven't seen in several years. So the playbook in a low interest rate environment has been for CIOs to invest in bonds and collect that fixed income payment. And if rates were stable or going down, they could get a fair total return by doing that. The reality now is that in an inflationary environment, you need an income component, but you need an income component that grows over time and that grows with inflation. And real estate really fits that bill. So we're really starting to see chief investment officers move allocations from bonds and to real estate to take advantage of the growth that they can get in an inflationary environment. High net worth and retail investors are looking at REIT funds to accomplish a couple of goals. Number one, they're getting diversification in what would be a typical stock and bond portfolio. REITs are generally have low correlations with global stocks and bonds. And they're getting a property type or an asset class that has shown good returns over time, about a 10% return on average over time. So when you put that in a portfolio, it really improves your position, your portfolio optimization mix. Now, they're also looking at, similar to institutional investors, looking at inflation protection within their real estate allocation. So we're starting to see people move again out of bond allocations into inflationary protection asset classes like real estate to mitigate or to benefit really from the inflationary environment that we're in right now. So fund flows for the category prior to the pandemic and into the pandemic had not been that robust, that a lot of people looked at real estate and were a bit more interested in whether it was fixed income, pure income components with a low interest rate environment, or higher growth assets, technology type growth assets prior to the pandemic. Now, I think the pandemic reset all that. When you saw the great reset in real estate during the pandemic, where prices went down, real estate was hit hard, it was impacted the most direct, really, out of any sector in the equity markets. You saw investors start to get more interested because they could start to see the growth coming in as we get out of the pandemic. And so fund flows have turned very positive in 2021. We've had one of our best years in terms of fund flows in the past 5 or 6 years. And investors are looking at it for inflation protection and relative value. They like the valuations relative to the equity markets and the bond markets, where we're consistently seeing new highs and new highs across the world. We hadn't really seen that in real estate for much of 2021. In terms of overweights and underweights in the PGIM Real Estate Global Select Fund, there are many themes that we're benefiting from that were overweight in the portfolio. And if you look at the reflation theme, we are overweight as a result of increasing inflation. We're overweight the apartment and self-storage sector globally. Number one, on the apartment and housing side, there is a severe shortage of housing across the world, particularly mid-level priced housing. So that's benefiting owners of apartments as they're able to increase their rents quickly. Self-storage, short-term leases, benefiting from the dislocation in COVID, and a very low labor cost associated with it, so not impacted by inflation on the cost side. And then the reopening theme that we've seen, we're overweight reopening names like healthcare, assisted living facilities, where we've seen pent-up demand for people to move in. A lot of that is needs-based to go into one of those facilities. And hotels, where we've seen leisure travel was very robust in the summer and continues to do a little bit better than expected even in the fall. But now the next wave or leg that we're going to see on the reopening is corporate travel, and there's pent-up demand for that. So we think that will pick up going forward. And then we like global logistics and industrial. We continue to see great earnings growth, earnings beats, you know, high single digit type earnings growth, and valuations continue to go up as a result of that. We continue to revise our estimates up on the industrial and warehouse names. So the top picks in the fund can fit into many of the themes that we have and are very optimistic about right now, whether it's reflation, reopening, or recalibration. And the top names really can fit in each of those categories. They hit check boxes in each of those three categories. So a company like Welltower, which is an assisted living company, those leases are generally short term. They're usually about a year, so that benefits the reflationary component. The reopening component, Welltower, the occupancies were hit very hard in during COVID in 2020, but we're starting to see that come back. Those move-ins have picked up significantly, and people typically have to sell their houses to finance a stay in an assisted living facility. The housing market is as strong as it's ever been. So demand has spiked for that as we get into the recovery, has spiked for assisted living. And then the recalibration, Welltower is a great example of a company that is using big data and artificial intelligence to make better, not only better revenue management decisions, but better decisions on acquisitions and development, really looking at submarkets and micro markets and using big data to identify, you know, the best opportunities for themselves. There have been a lot of studies which show that adding at least 10% of a real estate or REIT allocation, but more likely something closer to 20%, has added to the return and reduce the risk of the portfolio of a typical 60-40 stock bond portfolio. So you've been able to optimize your portfolio by investing in REITs. And why is that? It's because REITs have a low correlation on a relative basis to bonds and stocks. And historically, the returns have been quite strong. You've seen a historical long-term return of 10% or so. So many investors are doing it to take advantage of that diversification, optimize their portfolio. And then many investors are taking a real hard look at it right now, given the reflation that we've seen in the world and an inflationary environment where they have that protection. As inflation occurs, you can pass that through in many cases on the real estate side. So in terms of expectations, medium to long term, real estate is, we're at a very dynamic point right now. So there's the opportunity to create value in the space right now. There's going to be dispersion. There's going to be winners and losers. So I think what you could expect is that active management in the space will do well in the midterm to long term. A lot of these trends are in early stages. And that the space is poised because you've got so many of these property types to, you know, perhaps get returns that are above and beyond what we've seen in the past cycle, because you've got property types like data centers, cell towers, healthcare, where the market is still growing. They're not as cyclical. So some of the cyclicality that we've historically seen in REITs should be dampened or muted a bit as these non-core property types continue to grow. So the cycle will look very different going forward over the medium to long term. Location is still very important for real estate. However, the days of just getting a well-located building and just collecting the rent check and not doing any intense asset management, property management, are really not going to be enough in today's environment. With REITs, it's good real estate, well-located real estate, but I would say that the most important part really is having a good management team. Will your management team make the right capital allocation decisions to add value to you as a shareholder? That's really the threshold question. There are managers who have had good real estate who have destroyed value over time. There's managers who have had not so good real estate who have created value over time because they've made the right decisions on that real estate. So for us, it's a combination of well-located real estate and a really good management team.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.